Okay, class, let's talk about finding derivatives using the power rule. Now, I know what you're thinking. A power rule? Are you kidding me? I don't need to see a film on the power rule. Power rule is easy, easiest thing in America. I can do the power rule with half my brain tied behind my back crying out loud. I don't need the power rule video.
You're all worthless and weak. I'm dropping, give me 20.
Okay, you're not that bad off, but we need some practice on this stuff because I'm here to tell you that the power rule, you can have some fairly complex problems in dealing with the power rule. So I want to make sure that you guys are in business here and are seeing the types of questions you'll see come Foster Wheeler AP exam time in dealing with the power rule. So here's the first point of emphasis. When you're taking derivatives using the power rule, I have a warning for you. The first is, make sure you're using the power rule on power functions. Seems quite obvious. But we're talking about a function like this. If f of x equals x to the third, that's a power function. And I can find its derivative. Using the power rule is 3x squared, no mystery. But some calculus students make this mistake. They get a function like f of x equals 3 to the x, where the x is in the exponent. This is not a power function. This is an exponential function when the x is in the exponent. That might ring a bell for you with what you've learned previously in class. So we don't have means in our toolbox yet to take the derivative of an exponential function. But I can tell you what not to do. Don't use the power rule. How do you take the derivative of this? We'll talk about that later. But for now, just understand that all of these examples are going to be power functions where we have to use the power rule, and they're not going to be elementary, and they're either going to be intermediate or intermediate slash difficult. So you can hit pause on every problem, and if you think you're big stuff, find the derivative on your own and see if our answers match. Otherwise, take a look and see if you can be a sponge and soak some of this stuff up. All right, so here's our third example. Y equals x to the 5/3. So some students have difficulty. The exponent is a fraction. So I know that I go power times the coefficient. 5/3 times 1 is 5/3. How about the exponent? I got to subtract 1 from the exponent. As a fraction, I'm going to subtract with common denominator 3/3. This gives me what's left over, exponent of power 2/3. Final answer, y prime equals 5/3 x to the 2/3. This video, we're going to do 10 total examples. Here comes example 4. F of x equals 1 over x to the 5th. So a lot of these problems, before you take a derivative, you will have to reformat the original so it appears as a power function. This does not appear as a power function right now. I need to rewrite this as x to the negative 5th power. Now it appears as a power function, and I'm able to take its derivative, negative 5x to the negative 6th. Don't make a mistake and call that power to the negative 4th. If you lose $5, then you lose one more. You've lost $6. You have to subtract 1 from the exponent when you use the power rule. Here comes number 5. Now, sometimes you see a variable that you're a little uncomfortable with. This is the Greek letter alpha. H of alpha equals 1 over the 4th root of alpha. Again, reformatting this problem before you attempt to take the derivative is important. I would first reformat this and get rid of the 4th root and rewrite that as 1 over alpha to the 1/4 power. Then I would make that a power function by taking that alpha to the 1/4 power and writing it in the numerator. Now I have a true power function. Exponent times coefficient, and then subtract 1 from the exponent. We're looking at a derivative equal to negative 1/4 alpha, subtract 1 from the exponent. I'm subtracting 1, or 4 over 4, getting final answer negative 5/4 power. Hope that makes sense to you. Let's keep trucking. Things are going to build to a little more difficult. This is number 6. Y equals 6x to the 3/2 minus 7x to the 1/2. So now I don't have understood 1 coefficients in front of the variable. So I'm in pretty good shape here. I got to go exponent times coefficient to find y prime. Well, I have to know how to multiply fractions. I got to go 6 times 3 halves. I make that 6 a 6 over 1, so I have a fraction times a fraction. I got a top-bottom relationship where I can simplify. And get 9 for my new coefficient. 9x to the, got to subtract 1 or 2 over 2 from the exponent. 9x to the 1 half minus 7 halves. Yeah, that's 1 half of 7. That's 7 halves, 1 half times 7. X to the, and again, I've got to subtract 1 or 2 over 2 in this case, is going to leave me with an exponent of negative 1 half. This is what the derivative is here for number 6. All right, let's keep getting a little more difficult. This is number 7. So the variable you're looking at here is another Greek letter. When you guys do your book assignment, you will see problems similar to this where they're using some Greek letters. I think in the directions, you have to look at them carefully. They tell you that A, B, and C are constants. And that's going to be important. I'll do an example with A, B, and C coming up here. Right now, you don't have any letters that are constants. The one variable you have is theta. So I'm looking at this. I'm going, geez, this division problem? I don't know how to use the power. This is definitely not a power function. What am I supposed to do with this? Well, when you have multiple terms over one term, you can always reformat this. This has got to catch your eye if you become a veteran calc student. A problem like this has got to catch your eye. Multiple terms, terms are separated by plus or minus signs. Multiple terms, in this case two terms, over one term can be reformatted by making this two fractions. So this function needs to be reformatted as a power function before taking the derivative. Here's how. Consider this. What if I gave you this? This is an aside. What if I gave you 6 plus 4 over 2? What's the answer? 6 plus 4 is 10 divided by 2 is 5. I get 5. Yeah, I agree with you. You get 10 over 2, which is 5. What if I challenge you to do this another way? Because this method is what you're going to do in order to reformat the original problem. What if I challenge you to write this a different way? Well, one thing I could do is go 6 over 2 plus 4 over 2. Take the multiple terms and go 6 over 2 plus the second term, 4 over 2. You got two fractions there. They both have the same denominator. I think when you do that, you'll get 3 plus 2. After all, 6 divided by 2 is 3, and 4 divided by 2 is 2. And you get 5. We got 5 either way. Okay? So now, let's apply that reformatting skill to problem number 7. So I'm going to rewrite this as two fractions. I have the numerator, first term, that's theta squared over 3 theta, plus the second term on top, 1 over 3 theta. Now I'm going to simplify further. Do you see this first fraction, how you have a theta squared on top and a 1 theta on the bottom? And I would ask the question, do you have more thetas on the top or bottom? I have more thetas on the top. Yeah, how many more? 1. So when you rewrite this, that first term becomes 1/3 theta. That lone duck theta is the 1 theta you had more. You had 1 theta more on top than you did down low. The 1/3 comes from an understood 1 in front of the fraction here. So that's how I stole the fraction 1/3. I have 1/3 theta plus, and I took the theta that's downstairs in the second term and rewrote it upstairs so that it appears as a power function. Now I'm here to take the derivative. I'm prepared now after the reformatting using that strategy. I call that strategy Fruit Loops, where I can kind of loop up the first term over the denominator plus loop up the second term over the denominator. I call that Fruit Loops to rewrite this and reformat it. I'm now prepared to take the derivative. F prime of theta equals 1/3 theta minus 1/3 theta to the, got to subtract 1, negative second power. Done. Next problem. G of x equals e to the pi plus x to the pi. So students have difficulty with this stuff because they get confused what's a variable and what's a constant. If I asked you on the first day of class, hey, what's pi? You'd say 3.14. I'd say, okay, describe what pi is. Hopefully you'd say, oh, that's the comparison in any size circle between its circumference and its diameter always equals 3.14159, blah, blah, blah. But pi is a constant. You've also learned so far in class that E is another constant, approximately equal to 2.72. What I'm suggesting here is that when you figure out the derivative, you have to know that e to the pi is just a constant, raised to the constant, to a constant. E to the pi is 2.72 raised to the 3.14 power. Yeah? Yeah, so what's the derivative of a constant? The derivative of a constant is zero. So when I find the derivative here, that first term has a derivative equal to zero. The second term has a variable, x, raised to a constant. Think of that as like x cubed. How would you take the derivative of x cubed? Well, the derivative of x cubed would be 3x squared, using the power rule. Same story here, except you have a little more complexity with the pi. So it's pi times the coefficient in front. Remember, this is just showing here the derivative of that constant is zero. So the variable pi is multiplied by the coefficient in front. Pi times 1 is pi, x, to the, and then I have to subtract 1 from the exponent. I would write that as pi minus 1. That's the kind of answer you'd see like in the back of your textbook. Here's number 9. And we're at the 12-minute mark. I got to get booking. In this problem, A, B, and C are constant. If you want, if it helps you, you can make A, B, and C equal to 2, 3, and 4. If you actually want to put those a constant in of your choosing, that might help your brain here. So as I do this, and I'm trying to find the derivative of the function j, I know j prime is equal to, well, the power of 4 on the x gives me 4x cubed. And that a over the bottom remains. Wait a minute, I thought the derivative of a constant was 0. It is when you have a standalone term that is a constant. But that constant remains when you have it as a denominator of a fraction. Okay? So that you guys have to understand that. Don't make that mistake. So now I leave the variable. The exponent is 2. I have 2ax over b. Minus c. Because if that last term was minus 5x, the derivative of 5x would be 5. So I'm just left with a constant c. Last problem, number 10. This is g of t equals root t times 2 plus t. Root t times quantity, 2 plus t, all over t cubed. First step, ask her out, treat her like a lady. I write that root t as t to the 1/2. Second step, tell her she's the one you're dreaming of. Do the distributive property here. So take that t to the 1/2 power and distribute it to both terms in the quantity. You've got a new function, looks like this. Still over Yeah, so here's what we're talking about. When you go t to the 1/2 times t to the first, when you have like bases, you add exponents. So to add the exponents, you need a like denominator. You have t to the 1/2 times t to the 2 over 2. Like bases add exponents, I get t to the 3/2. Remember, this is all over t cubed. Again, I'm only in the stage of reformatting this function. I haven't taken the derivative of squat. Third step, tell her she's the one you're dreaming of. I'm going to do Fruit Loops again. I have multiple terms over one term. It's going to give me 2t to the, let's see. I have t to the 1/2 over t cubed. Like bases, top, bottom, subtract exponents. I got to go 1/2 times 3, minus 3. Or 1/2 minus 6 over 2. which leads me to negative 5/6. So my first term now is 2t to the negative 5/6 power. Plus t to the like basis top bottom subtract exponents. I have 3 halves minus 3, or 3 halves minus 6 over 2, so I have like denominators. I do the math and get negative 3 halves. So I have negative 3 halves here. I've done a lot of work, 1, 2, 3 steps of work to arrive at a power function. But now that I have that clean power function, I ought to be able to use the power rule to arrive at its derivative g prime of t. So g prime of t equals, I go negative 5/6 times 2 and get negative 10/6, which can be reduced to negative 5/3. Ding! Negative 5/3 t. Now I got to subtract 1 from negative 5/6, which is negative 11/6. That's how I get that exponent. Minus 3/2 t. Yeah, negative 3/2 times 1 is minus 3/2. T to the, and I got to subtract 1 from the exponent. Negative 3/2 minus 2 over 2. Negative 5/2. Bang. Done. So you can see the power rule is a very, very simple thing when I give you a bunch of integers and positive exponents. Things can get pretty tough pretty fast when you are required 3 steps of reformatting before you're able to take the derivative. A lot of calc students have problems with fractions. Yeah, like the stuff they learned in 6th grade, fractions, multiplying fractions and combining fractions by finding like denominators. So you're going to get a chance to practice some of these on your homework, but here's some examples. You can go back through this video pretty easy and just fast forward through the easy ones and look more carefully at the tough ones so that you can get home. Okay? Hope you do well. Calculus, power functions, not so easy. Good luck. Over and out.